My name is Tisho Foley. I'm the deputy well engineer at the NTDF. I've been in that position for the last 2 weeks, 2 years. And when I call this presentation, well, Axila wants me to rule them all because, well, basically I'm going to talk about a script I've been working on during the last year. Yeah, I started after Rome because I had this idea, because previously when I started to work for PDF, well, I realized that sometimes, well, most of the times you can in Axila do queries to, you know, some specific queries to look for what you are looking for, but then sometimes it's just impossible in the website to find some specific actions that well, are like users can do them, like some changes to bugs that can be done, but then there's no possible. There's no possibility to drop those changes. So then it's difficult to have an idea of what's going on. So, yeah, first, well, this is a general overview of Axila. So right now we have almost 62,000 bugs reported. So basically, anyone with an account in Axila can do almost everything with any bug, change it in any way he wants. And well, that can be a problem because, well, you just need your email, and within 1 minute you have an Axila account. So then you can just do the changes at will. So, well, normally, well, users, they just do the right changes, but sometimes can be, you know, like they have done it in the wrong way. So we need a way to control them. So this is the number of bugs we got last year. So in average, we have around 600 reports in every month. So yeah, more than 7,000 bugs reported last year, and they were reported by almost 3,000 users. So that, well, this chart gives us an idea of the volume of bugs reported in Axila, well, the number of bugs that we have to deal with. So the same for comments, like almost 60,000 comments by almost 4,000 users. And then same for the changes done in Axila. So let's say you change one bug from unconfirmed to new, that would count as a change. So yeah, we have 53,000 changes done by 2,500 people. And yeah, last year we got more than 3,000 new users. So yeah, the question, well, like, I remember when I joined TDF, or I started to work for TDF, there was a discussion whether we should limit the options that normal users have, and if we should have a group of users, like admins, more advanced users, or keyway users, and then just normal users. Well, personally, my answer to that is no. I think I like how we work now, that everyone can change anything that you get it. So, yeah, so my answer would be like, no, we want the freedom to give the user the freedom to do whatever they want. There is just one exception. So we just, if you are a normal user in Axila,
We just, the only thing that you cannot change is the priority and security, but then everything else can be changed by a proper user. And personally, I like that they have that freedom, but at the same time, you have to control it in a way. So then, last year I realized that, we could use a way that automatically control what anyone is doing. So, 1.5 years ago, Jan Iversen started to work on a script that basically gets all the information from Maxilla and put it in a JSON document. So then, after he did that script, I thought, okay, I can use that data to do things automatically. So first thing I did was to create this weekly report that normally I send to the mailing list. So yeah, later on I thought, we can use also that data to control what's going on in Maxilla. So that is when this script came to mind, and yeah, I started to work. So the first thing I noticed that it's not possible to control using the website. It's that, normally when we have all bugs, we ask the reporters and the users in that bug to retest it again. So normally when there is 1 year of inactivity, we just send this email, this comment. We write this comment saying, please, could you please test again this bug and see if it's still reproducible. Normally, we get, after we pin these bugs, normally we get around 20% of the bugs fixed as work for me. So normally, what we do is to ask them to test that in the latest version to see if it's still reproducible. So the problem here is that, we have this field, which is version, and we just say, we just want to know the earliest version. So when we ask users to retest it in the latest version, what they do, if they don't know about the workflow before, they just change the version to the newest one. So that's wrong. And that was my first idea, to test this kind of things and check this kind of things. So now, the script just, if someone changed the version to the newest one, the script let me know, and then I change it back, because that's, when changing it to a newest version, it's not the correct way of, it's incorrect. We have the same for autoconfirm bugs. So in general, no one should confirm their own bugs unless, there are a couple of exceptions. So the first one is, if you are reporting a bug that you intend to work on that and fix it, then okay, go for it and assign it to yourself, and that's it. Or we have also a rule of thumb that, the bug is present, we just move it to new, because we don't want it to be unconfirmed, because it's a triage bug. So the problem with this is that, if you just, let's say a user just reports a bug and put it new, it's likely that no one is going to check that bug. So then we go on notice, and the bug will remain in Maxilla forever. So now with the script, it's possible also to check which bugs are auto-confirmed. So what I do is, when I get a notification that the bug is auto-confirmed, then I just, triage it, or I just put it back to unconfirmed, waiting for someone to triage it. Same for auto-fix bugs. So what I found is that, users, they report a bug, and then sometime later they found that the bug was fixed, or newer version and then it was fixed in the version. But then, well, so normally what they do is to put the status to resource fix, which is, well, in general, if you have a bug change to resource fix, it means there is a commit for that bug and someone fix it, developer fix it. So what I do is to say, well, we have a change in the status to resolve fix, and there is no target in the whiteboard, and then we don't have any comment saying, well, this bug was fixed by this commit. Normally, what I do is, well, first, I change the status and I do the right one, which is resolve all for me, and then next thing I do is to test if that bug is reproducible in a release branch. So if it's reproducible in a release branch, it means it needs to be backported. So then I normally try to find the commit fixing that bug, and if, well, it's not backported, then I go to everything, if possible, not always, but if possible, try to backport it. Same for the crash report field. So I don't know if you have noticed that we have this field in Baxilla. So well, you need to put it within brackets. So then the crash report website knows that there is a report in Baxilla pointing to that crashing record. So sometimes people just use this field incorrectly, so then I get a notification. Well, I get the, well, the script let me know that, well, this is incorrect, so I just change it accordingly. So then this means that this crash signature is pointing to this website, and also now it's possible, like you told me to add this to Baxilla. So now we have, it's also possible to have the URL of the class in the CLSON field. So now if we have a crash signature that we don't have in the URL, then I get the, well, the script lets me know and I just add it to the CLSON field. Same for keywords. So sometimes, well, nowadays, like almost everyone use Gary, but sometimes we see contributors, well, new contributors, that they just submit the patch to Baxilla, and normally they use the patch, well, there's a patch keyword. So in that case, well, then I know about that, and then I let the, well, I tell the user to instead submit the patch to Gary. Well, the problem with that before is that people used to submit patches to Baxilla. No one noticed them, and then, like, after 1 year or 2 years, it's like, oh, there's a patch here, but no one look at it, and then maybe the user is not involved anymore, so then we are just losing a contributor. Same for this possible regression keyword. So yeah, we have this keyword, this is from the wiki page. So if a user thinks that it might be a regression, then sometimes they use this possible regression keyword. The problem with that is that, well, they just add it waiting for someone from QA to triage that bug and see if it's indeed a regression or not, but I saw that in the past this keyword was using, but then no one from QA was later checking that bug. So now I just get a notification and then I just see if it's indeed a regression or not. And well, the same for regression keyword, normally it goes along with a privacy request. So I just get this. So if someone just adds the regression keyword, So then they know that they have to accept that. And the same the other, well, the other way around. Like we have the bypassing request, but we don't have the keyword regression. So basically, if we use bypassing request, it means that it's a regression, so it should be added to someone. And yeah, finally, we have this needs UXML, which should be also added with the email of the UX team. So sometimes people can use the keyword without adding the email, so then the UX team is not well. That's the way they work. I got only that the email should be added, so I just added this check. So now every time someone adds the keyword, if the email is not added, then I add it as well.
First, if the bug is indeed fixed, and then if there are any other related bugs.
So the way, the reason why I do regression bugs is that, well, in order to verify a regression, it's quite easy because I just move back in time and I see I see the problem first and then I just check in master if it's fixed. So I kind of verify every bug that gets fixed, because then otherwise it would be a lot of time. So at least what I try to do is verify those bugs which were in regressions. Yeah, and then I also check that, well, if the bug got fixed in master, well, it needs to be backported, then I just go to bear it and normally, or I ask the developer if this bug should be backported or something. Yeah, so another thing I check if, well, we have a bug which is unconfirmed, but all the comments are written by the reporter, and then the bug, well, it has been for 1 month without any activity. Normally, when I try to triage it, and the reason I do this is because, well, we want to get, to reduce the time we need to triage and unconfirm bug, and also, yeah, because sometimes we have unconfirmed bugs that if no one is looking at them, they just remain unconfirmed forever. So with each, what I try to do is to at least, well, if no one is doing anything for a month, then I try to jump in and do it myself. Yeah. So the same I do like with unconfirmed bugs, with comments from different people, but then I check if the last comment is not done by the reporter. Well, what it means is that, let's say one bug, well, we have a reported, we have a reported bug, then someone else from the QA team is asking for more information, but then the bug remains in unconfirmed status for a month, then I just get a notification about this bug, and, well, what I do is, well, let's say last comment from the QA, from someone who is not important, is asking for information, then I put the bug in need info. Or otherwise, I guide to a triage myself. Yeah, this is, well, I found this one, they are pretty good, because, well, what we do in the Get Involved page is to, well, in order to get newcomers involved in the project, involved in QA, well, we ask them if they, one of the tasks they can do is to confirm bugs. But then the problem is that, well, if you just check, like, someone new in the project, okay, let's, he just downloads the latest version, check one bug and say, okay, this bug is reproducible in the latest version, then it's moved to new, but maybe no one else will jump in and say, okay, I would like to. So I should have tried with a previous version and see if it's a regression or not. So now when this happens, someone is confirming a bug, but it's not changing the version, so it's just checking it with the latest version. Then I get a notification. Normally what I do is to reproduce or find out, see if that bug is indeed a regression, so I just check it in previous versions of LibreOffice. So I've been using this check for, like, I implemented it like 2 months ago, and I think it's helping a lot, because now that it's reducing the time, a regression is found. Yeah, the same for meta bugs. So let's say a bug is moved to new, it's properly triaged, but then we don't have it a meta bug for that bug. So then I also get a notification saying, okay, this bug is not, well, it was confirmed recently, but it's not, it doesn't have a meta bug. So yeah, this is important as well, because sometimes you find that if you add a meta bug to a bug, then looking at the list list of metal of bugs in that metabug, then you can do the case. And it's also later good for developers to, well, if they are just working in a specific area of LibreOffice, then they just can go to the metabug list and, you know, like go through that list and work on that specific area. Yeah, same for need info bugs. So sometimes we ask the reporters to provide information, so we just move the bugs to need info, and then what happened in the past is that, well, like, sometimes the reporters, they provide the information back, but we didn't move the bug to another status. So then this bug remained in need info forever, and in the end it got closed. So that's a really bad workflow, because we are asking for information to the reporter provided that information, but then in the end we are just doing nothing with that bug. So now it's as possible to check this. And yeah, the same with bugs that got fixed, but then suddenly they are reopened later on. So what we had in the past is that sometimes we have bugs that got fixed, and then 6 months later someone is checking with an old version and says, no, this bug is still open. So yeah, then I also check this, and well, if right now if I get a bug which is resolved fixed, so it means we have a problem that someone fixes it, then if it's reopened, I just get a notification and then just leave a comment saying, okay, you should then close. Well, this bug should be closed if you're still reproducing something similar, please create and follow up that. Yeah, finally, let's do more slides. So, with this script, I also know, well, I can also know when we have new contributors in the project. So the first, or they just sign up in Pasila, and they have, well, what I do is if they check, well, I check if they have contributed to more than 3 bugs, or they have not any acts on more than 3 bugs. Well, normally what I do is I send them a welcoming email privately. So the reason I'm doing this is just to try to approach them in a personal, like, privately, so try to engage them in the project, giving them some pointers. Yeah, in general, I've done it with around 100 users, and well, sometimes I don't get any answer back, but in general, it's quite positive, because they are like, oh yeah, thank you for your email. Yeah, I'm really interested in accepting your offers and so on. And the same I do with all contributors. So yeah, like, what I do is to check which was the last action of a person in Maxilla, and if that person was involved or was, you know, like changing like more than 20 bucks, then I suppose that person was an active contributor in the past. So what I do now is when I get a notification for that, then I just send them a WinVisio email saying, well, like, we did great, you did great in the past, and yeah, we would like to help you back if you can. So yeah, this also, yeah, it works sometimes. I sometimes don't get any answer back, but yeah, people, they are like, yeah, I would like to, you know, right now I can, but maybe in the future and so on. So yeah, at least it's a way to try to give those people in the project. So that's basically it, and yeah, thank you for